Jesus Christ, our living hope, my living hope. And if you are a child of God this morning, your living hope. Welcome to the live broadcast this morning, Sunday, November the what? 29th. Wow, tomorrow my oldest brother, if he was here, he would have been what? 78 years old. Mm-hmm. Glory to God. So he went on a few years ago. So, but I still remember his birthday. He was my oldest. Mm-hmm. He was the one we grew up together and we fought every day. But still love each other. Nobody came between us. Yeah. Amen. That's what flesh and that's why brothers are. Just like us in Christ, no matter what, with our disagreement sometimes, we are brothers, we are one in Christ. Amen. We are the body of Christ. And we belong to one another. And that's why we are here, Freedom in Christ, this morning, helping our brother, us, as a matter of fact, to grow in the grace and the knowledge of Him who loved us and gave Himself for us. We thank God for you and you. Thank God for Pastor Davis here with us this morning. I see Chris is on. I see Kenneth is on. Glory to God. It's just like we have in church, every one of us having church together this morning. We thank God. Then that's the church. Well, this was now. That's the church. The body of Christ is all over the world. So today, even though we're reaching you from in Africa, in the West Indies, or wherever you are, any part of the world, you are our brothers and sisters in Christ. God bless you. And this time, we're going to call my wife. She's going to come and greet you. Greet us. Amen. And then she's going to call Pastor Davis to greet us, and then I'll come back and have share something good with us.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Good morning. Good afternoon in some countries, going to be evening in others. But we just give thanks to God for today. Give Him praise, honor, and glory. All goes to Him. I would just like to read from Romans 12 in the NIV, New International Version, Romans 12. I might do all of it, but especially the first part. And it reads, "Therefore I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your body as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the patterns of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, His good, pleasing, and perfect will. For by the grace given, I say to every one of you, do not think of yourself more highly than you ought, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment, in accordance with the faith of God has distributed to each of you. For just as each of us have one body with many members, and these members do not have the same function, so in Christ we, though many, form one body, each member belongs to all the others. We have different gifts according to grace given to each of us. If your gift is prophesying, then prophesy in accordance with your faith. If it is serving, then serve. If it's to encourage, then give encouragement. If it's giving, then give generously. If it's to lead, do it diligently. If it's to show mercy, do it cheerfully. Love must be sincere. Hate what is evil, cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another. Honor one another above yourself. Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor serving the Lord. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer. Share with the Lord's people who are in your need. Practice hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Mourn with those who mourn. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be proud, but willing to associate with people of low position. Do not be conceited. Do not repay anyone for evil. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everyone. If it is possible, as far as it depends upon you, live at peace with everyone. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Do not take revenge, my dear friends, but leave room for God's wrath. What is written, it is mine to avenge. I will repay, saith the Lord. On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he thirsty, give him something to drink. If doing this, you will heaping burn coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. We thank the Lord for his word. Words of encouragement.
Praise God.
Everything is in his hands. And we just present our bodies to him as our true proper worship.
Amen.
Pastor Amen. Davis will come now and greet
Praise
you.
The Lord. Amen. Thank you, Lord.
Amen. Glory. Good morning, everyone out there across the globe.
Good morning.
Gregory passage. Sister Hannah just read just now. Romans 12. Romans is a very good book in general.
Amen.
It really is. It separates the law from the grace. There's a distinction, a clear distinction in the book of Romans. I encourage every believer to really get into that book. Really understand God's grace and what Christ has done for you and the finished work he has done for you. We're all servants. That's the one thing that stood out to me in that passage this morning. We're servants, and sometimes it's going to require us to put others first before ourselves in some instances.
Amen.
We're not saying every single instance, but it comes times where we must deny ourselves as believers and put other people before ourselves and serve. And serve and to help meet the need according to God's will in people's lives, because God wants to live through us to touch others. That's his objective for living in us, and not for us to be complete and fulfilled in him, but it's also for him to live through us to touch the world around us. So that's my encouragement this morning to you all. Tune into my brother here as he preaches his message, and tune in and take notes if you have to. Get the word, get the truth, and have a blessed day in Jesus' name.
Praise God. Amen. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Bless you. Praise the Lord. Oh, I missed this. I was supposed to get something. I left it. Oh, man. I'm sorry. I wasn't prepared. I was playing a song last night. I just wanted to sing a real few verse of it. What did I do it? there's a song that says, glory, glory, hallelujah. Since I laid my burden down, I feel better, so much better. Since I laid my burden down, hallelujah. I'm not a singer, but one thing I can tell you, friends, I can make a joyful noise unto the Lord.
So that matters.
With that song I was listening to last night, and I had it on my phone. I said I'm going to play it. The gentleman was playing his guitar, and the young lady was singing like the old slave rhythm, you know.
Spiritual, yes.
And it's so, I mean, you need to bring this back in the church today, the Christianity today. Mm-hmm. Because what I can sing that song with all the conviction in the world. Since I laid my burden down, amen. The burden down is laying away aside the weight that so easily beset me, and I start understanding truth that is not me. Mm-hmm. What I do is what Jesus did.
Right.
Man, this was victory for me. Victory for me that Christ is alive, living in me. I can't say this enough, friend. Every time you hear me, you're going to hear me talking about that verse of scripture. Colossians chapter 1 and verse 27. Because so many Christians, so many believers today, don't even understand that Jesus Christ is alive, living in them. They think that Jesus is just in heaven. He said he went back. Before he went back, he said, when I go, I will send you the what? The Comforter. So the Holy Spirit is here today. That's what we're going to talk about this morning. The Holy Spirit of God living in us. Christ alive, living in us. Walking by the Spirit. Amen. Because you are a child of God. So God is wanting you to walk after the Spirit. Paul says in Galatians, do not walk after the flesh. Yeah, we have the flesh with us. The flesh will always be here with us until we die. You know? And that's why people are confused, you know. Oh, you can see I'm free from sin. And then yeah, but no, you have the indwelling sin in you because the flesh have the flesh. You got control. If you're not in Christ, you don't have no control over it. That's who you are. That's part of you. But if you're in Christ, the Bible says you are in control. And Paul says, walk after the Spirit.
Amen.
And you will not fulfill the desires of the flesh. Amen. Mankind was created by God to live in the dependency upon his Creator. Not independent from his Creator. Whenever we refuse to live in dependency upon Christ, we are forced to depend upon who? Satan, the flesh, and things. Well, Satan, the media, amen, and the things of the world for our meaning and purpose to life. Don't you know that if you're not depending on the Lord Jesus Christ, whatever, when you turn your television on, when you turn your radio on,
uh-oh,
and they tell you what to think, you're going to just think. You're not going to think for yourself. You have, like you have no mind of your own. Now, you're a child of God. Living the Christian life this morning is so important. So important that you and I should be aware of. Amen. Man's need to live in dependency on Christ. That's how he made us. Amen. Jesus said in John Gospel 15 and 4 said, Jesus was speaking to the disciples. He's speaking, say, remain in me, and I will remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Come on, visualize a tree with me. Amen. Visualize the tree, that's the vine. That's who is the vine. Jesus is the vine. Just visualize a tree that is planted here this morning. Glory to God. And he got branches all over. With the branch, if you cut the branch, what happened? It's no longer part of the vine. Well, so Jesus is saying, remain in me. Amen. And I will remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. Amen. Everybody wants to preach and teach and do all kind of stuff, but they never came to the Lord. They're not in the Lord, number one. So how are they going to remain in him? You know, I posted on Facebook the other day. A lot of people say they call, I'm called to preach, mm-hmm. but never was called to Jesus. You're called to preach, but never were called to Jesus. The vine is Jesus Christ, friend. Jesus is that vine. Oh, glory to God. And I in him, he will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. You hear that, brothers and sisters, this morning? Apart from Jesus Christ, we can do nothing. Everything that we do in the flesh is useless. It's useless. Mm-hmm. Amen. Amen. A branch doesn't produce fruit, it bears fruit. We don't produce no fruit. All these guys and them that calling you down the aisle every morning, every Sunday morning, and putting hand and pushing you down. You know, amen. That doing that thing in the flesh. No, Jesus never called people like that. Amen. That's not of God. The effect of something is never greater than the cause. In natural lives, by the law of causality, for example, the brilliance of the sun is not greater than the sun. Mm-hmm. Amen. Mm-hmm. My salvation is not greater than my who?
Savior.
Hallelujah. The creation is not greater than the creator. Glory to God. A house is not greater than the builder. Hallelujah. God is in. We love because He first loved us. 2,000 years ago, friends, because of the love for you see, He foresee you even now. He foresee us even now. 2,000 years ago, He said, man, for God, I love this people. I love Joe Regis. I love Han. I love Salem. I said it right, right? Did I say it right? I love Lee. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Your wife says it right.
Yeah. I love Kenneth. I love Chris. I love Chili. I love everybody that I can see online that I will give. I will become a man. I will become a man and come and die for you, because without the shedding of blood there is no forgiveness for sin. The bulls and goats and all the animal sacrifice was able to cover sin, but He was not able to take them away. So Jesus Christ came down. When John saw Him coming, he said, behold, the Lamb of God. You see, God became man and came and died for you and for me. Amen. John said, behold, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. So Jesus had to come. God had to come in the form of Jesus to take away the sin. Do it, the Bible says in Hebrews, He did it once and for all times, and for everybody, even those that wasn't born yet, mom and dad, grandma and grandpa wasn't born yet, because it was 2,000 years ago. But He took the sins away at the cross. Glory to God. Because why? He knew that all men were born in sin and with that sin nature, because of Adam and Eve that disobeyed God. In the garden, God told them, Adam, I love you, Adam. I'm giving you all this garden, this whole garden, with all these fruits and vegetables, but there is one in the garden, that corner right there. You see that one over there? If you only touch it, that was a deception when Eve, yes. The serpent said that, yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah, he said, if you only eat of this fruit, you will surely die. And you know the story. The whole story is that the woman was tempted by Satan. and still is. Mm-hmm. Glory to God. The woman is the weaker vessel. Mm-hmm. Yeah, they are. Yeah, that's what the Bible says. I'm not saying that because I'm thinking I'm more manly. No, I'm saying that because this is what the Bible says. And as she ate, she believed a lie. Amen. She believed a lie. And she ate. And she went and gave her husband. And he loved her so much. So he ate too. And what happened to him? He died, the Bible says. Both of them died. The day they ate of the fruit, they died. Did they die physically? No. They died spiritually. Amen. So every one of us was born in the image of who? Are we born in the image? Are we created in God's image? No, we were born in the image of Adam. In the image of Adam we were born. So we're born in sin and shaping iniquity. Glory to God. So Jesus Christ went to the cross and took away the sin of the world. He settled that once and for all. But there is one thing, friend, that a lot of people don't understand that scripture. They don't understand the meaning of it. They don't understand the thing. Well, Jesus took away the sin of the world. Why do I have to receive Christ? Christ said, that's the only sin that you have to be corrected, friend. Jesus, before he went back to his Father, he said, the world's sin, S-I-N, is unbelief in me. That is a sin unto death. The sin of unbelief in Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. So his love for us is so, so important, understanding it. Glory to God. 1 John 4:10. This is the love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as the propitiation and for our sins. That's the key word there. That's the key word there. Amen. Modern day Christianity has developed a case of spiritual dyslexia. Dyslexia. Amen. Yes. God. When you know the truth, brother, when God teach you the truth, you look back and say, wow, was I involved in that stuff? Mm-hmm. Yes. Some of you don't know the truth right now, and yes, you are involved in it. It's deep, my friend. It's very deep. It's just deep, like a deep state. I'm sorry. It's political. Yeah, it's deep, friend. It's legalism is deep. And keep you in bondage. My desire this morning is to set you free. Help you to be free. Not me. I can't set you free. I can even give you the information. And it's up to you what you do with the information. Amen. You could get a lot of information and still don't do anything. And do anything with it. Amen. There was a guy that was drunk and he wanted somebody to help him save his life. And somebody threw a book to him. read the instruction how to be free. And he read the book, yeah. At that time he don't need instruction then. Amen. The instruction has he need to get out from the water. Amen. The person, one guy came up, and that's my own little story I'm making up here. the other guy came up and he dived down. He took him up. And they said in my first aid class, never you put somebody in front of you when you're trying to save them from the water. If not, you got to. I think there's a way you got to turn away from that person. Both of you going down. Both of you going down because mm-hmm. he's going mm-hmm. to do this. And, yeah, but when he got him out of the water and he delivered him safe to the shore, he saved his life. Amen. False teaching emphasize emphasize the size of our faith rather than the bigness of God. Yeah, that's all you hear in the false teaching. Mm-hmm. Oh, your faith had to be big. If you didn't get certain thing, that means you don't have big faith. Amen. Faith. Uh-huh. And that's false teaching, friend. That's false teaching. Amen. Matthew 17:20 says, he replied, Jesus replied, because you have so little faith. I tell you the truth. If you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you can say to the mountain, move from here to there, and it will move. Do you ever see anybody, I'm older than most of you probably here this morning. I've been in Christ for 47 years. I've never seen anybody, any preacher, any so-called preacher move any mountain. They can't. But so Jesus was giving them a parable there, an example. So, well, Jesus said, if you have faith like a grain of mustard seed, you'll say the mountain, and they dwell on that. But they don't understand the scripture, the meaning of it. Jesus was just telling you. He said, if. Eh? Did he say that? If you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you can say to the mountain, move. If you have it. That means you don't have even a small mustard seed faith. Glory to God. Amen. Hallelujah. It emphasized prayer to get rather than prayer to acknowledge what you already have. See, that's what we already have. We have a big God who already gave it to us. Amen. So Jesus was trying to tell you that. Amen. You don't have a mustard seed faith, but you have what? A big God. I'm a God. I'm the one created everything. Amen. There's nothing that was made that was not made by me. Everything. The Bible said that. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. All things, the Bible says, were created by Him. By Him, friend. His name is Jesus, friend. His name is Jesus. Amen. God is great, is the creator of initial all things. Man is responder to all things God has created and initiated. We're just responders. We can't create anything. Everybody giving themselves a tap on the back and say, oh, I did this. Mm-hmm. Me. Yeah, yeah. Anytime you hear them preachers talking like that, run away from them. It's nothing to do with you. There's nothing you can do. I cannot do anything, friend, except the Lord Jesus Christ. Do it in and through me. I do nothing. Jesus is speaking. John 5:19-30. I do nothing unless the Father tells me to do it. See, he was God, perfect God. Perfect man, but he was depending on the Father while he was here on earth. Amen. Anything that Jesus did, he did it because the Father told him to do it. When Lazarus was raised from the dead after dying and stinking already for 3 days. 4 days, sorry. Yeah, 4 days. God, the Father. He had to depend on the Father. You remember when he prayed? What he said? Father, when I pray, what? You always hear me. So he did everything according to what the Father told him to do. I say nothing unless the Father tells me to say, for I did not speak of my own accord, but the Father who sent me commanded me what to say and how to say it. John 12:49. You can read the scripture for yourself, friend. Amen. John 8:28 says, so Jesus said, when you have lifted up the Son of Man, then you will know that I am the one. I claim to be, and that I do nothing of my own, but speak just what the Father has taught me. Is the Father teaching you anything this morning? Yes, he's teaching me. Amen. Mm-hmm. Another scripture, John 14:10-11. Don't believe that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me. The words I say to you are not just my own. Rather, it is the Father living in me. Amen. Who is doing his work? Believe me when I say that I am in the Father and the Father is in me. Or at least believe on the evidence of the miracles themselves. Amen. Glory to God. As the Father has sent me, so send I you. To the disciples there. As the Father has sent Jesus, amen. Send the other apostles, Paul and everybody. Amen. So he's sending us this morning. He's sending us this morning for our purpose. Amen. This world needs Jesus, friend. This world need Jesus. You know, people don't understand. People, Christians, please ask the Lord to give you that revelation. I mean, ask him to give you the revelation that he gave me. We are facing serious days, serious times. Amen. Unless you trust in him, friend, you will crumble. First Peter 2:21-23. To this you were called because Christ suffered for you, leaving you an example that you should follow in his step. He committed no sin. Remember that? And no deceit was found in his mouth. When they hurled their insult at him, he did not retaliate when he suffered. He made no threat. Instead, he entrusted himself to him who judges justly. 1 Peter 2:21-23. They're going to come at you, friend. Matter of fact, they're coming at us already. They are coming at us. See? They find the plan and they just close you down. They just close the church. Close your mouth. They can't close your mouth. They can close the door, the building. And people are not even waking up and realizing what is going on. It takes a revelation from the Lord, friend. Ask him to reveal this wonderful truth to you this morning. It takes a revelation. Amen. Amen. There's a result of living in dependency on Christ. You will be filled with the Spirit. Do not be drunk, the Bible says in Ephesians 5:18. Do not be drunk with wine, where it leads to deep debauchery. Instead, be filled with the Spirit. That's Ephesians 5:18. Amen. What do you mean by that, though? What's the meaning of that? Amen. Do not be drunk with wine, but be filled with the Spirit. When you came to Christ, friend, you are baptized by the Spirit into the body of Christ. In other words, you are born again of the Spirit. And depend on all the Lord is asking you, us this morning to do, is to depend on that. Know that I am in you and you are in me. Whatever you depend upon, meaning and purpose to life, will control you. There's a lot of Christians this morning, born again, that are allowing other stuff to control them instead of being controlled by the Holy Spirit. Like some alcohol. The first day I went to this brother's house many years ago in New York City, and I saw him had all his Guinness. You know what Guinness Stout is? Mm-hmm. Man, that blew me away, because all my life as a Christian, under the legalism, think, well, if a Christian only drink a Guinness, he's lost. Yeah, popularity, drugs, job, yeah, that's Christian allowing that to control their life. Amen. All the scripture is saying to you and me this morning is, don't allow this to control you. Allow the Spirit to control you. Amen. Just like the brother that we met in one church one time, and he was so drunk, he was controlled by alcohol. And he was a Christian. And the other believers there, some of them call themselves, well, I think there were two or three bishops there, the names there only. They were there and they were praying, laying hands on this guy. And this guy was confused, because he was dependent on alcohol. He's a child of God now, have dependence in the wrong place. Amen. Until God allowed me, lead me to, and my wife was standing there, so she is my witness. God led me to this young man, and I went to him. I obeyed the Spirit of God. And I went to this young man and I said, what is going on with you, man? I said, my name is Joe. What is going on with you? And he told me, I'm an alcoholic. Because they lied to him. The devil lied to him. A child of God. We're not talking about a lost person now. We're talking about one who are born again. One who accepted Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior. When you do that, Christ don't grant charges. It comes and lives in you by faith. When you receive it, say, anyone receive me, I will in no wise what? Cast them out. Whoever come unto me, I will receive them. He said, come unto me, all ye that heavy laden, and I will give you rest. So he came to Christ many years ago, but somehow never taught about who he is, his identity in Christ. And I'm allowing alcohol to control him. Amen. Some people love popularity, drugs, job. Amen. Amen. But I went up to this brother and I said, and he told me what happened. And I told him the truth, friend. I told him the truth. And that man, from that day, had never took another drink, because he understood that that time his true identity in Christ. He allowed the Holy Spirit to control him. Amen. That's what I'm saying here this morning. Just do whatever sex, whatever controlling you, you're a child of God. I'm talking to the children of God this morning. Whatever is controlling you, amen. And we all in the flesh, you know, we all in the flesh. If you're not careful, that stuff will control you. Anything else, anything but Christ. You know, anything but Christ. But Christ wants you to depend on him. We were created that way. We were born that way. Our dependency should be on the Lord Jesus Christ always. Amen. The love of God controls Paul. 2 Corinthians 5:14. For Christ's love compels us, amen, because we are convinced that one died for all, and therefore all died. Yes, he did. Are you convinced this morning? The love of God controls Jesus, yes. Amen, because I told you he was perfect God, perfect man. But he never used his deity when he was here. He allowed the Father to control him. He depended on the Father all the time. And he's running late. So I'm going to speed it up. In order to be controlled by God's love, you have to know and understand what God's love is. Okay? Oh, I love the Lord, but you don't know that God loves you? You have to know and understand it. Not just knowing, but understanding. Amen, that he loves you unconditional. God's love is an action taken on behalf of man. God is always patient. God is always kind. God is never easily angry. not angry, but eager with you. Angry with you, sorry. God never keeps record of your wrong. Oh, preacher, that's what you're saying to me? I never heard that before. I thought I heard that he's writing everything that I do wrong. He's writing it down in the book. No, friends, if you're a child of God, he never keep record of your wrong. He gave it to Jesus Christ at the cross. Amen. God never delights in evil. You know, some people say, God gave me this message. But the message is evil. He never delights in evil. Amen. There's a lot of liars over there. God always rejoices in truth. Every time. 100% of the time. God always protects. God always protects you as a child of God. If you're in Christ this morning, you are protected by the beloved. Amen. God always trusts you. Yes, he trusts you. He's your daddy. He's our daddy. Not your daddy only, my daddy too. So you always trust us. You know, or sometimes a father never trusts his children. They never trust. No, but God is greater than your father in the flesh. Yeah? He's greater than him. So God always trusts you. God always hopes the best for you and me. Yes. We think the best is material thing. No, man, that too, but that's not what he's talking about. He's talking about spiritual stuff. Amen. God always persevere. God never fails. Amen. And I was gonna come and tell you about what man thinks, but I'm gonna leave that alone. Just leave God there. Just leave God that in your mind. That who God is. Amen. Amen. God loves you unconditionally. Oh yeah? I thought I had to do certain things. I thought I had to go to church. I thought I had to pray five times a day. I thought I had to give tithings. Yep. I thought I had to feed the poor. I thought I had to do all that stuff. Eh? For God to love me. No, friends. God loves you unconditional. And if because you understand that, then you do stuff like that. You give offering. I don't preach tithing here.
That's right.
And we don't preach tithing here. If you come to our assembly, you don't see an offering plate pass. We don't do that. No. If you want to give, there is a box out there. You give freely from your heart. We don't preach tithing. Tithing is old covenant. All we preach is new covenant, New Testament giving. And Paul says it in so well in Corinthians. He said, give freely from your heart. Give as the Lord blesses you. And who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, hardship, persecution, famine, nakedness, danger, or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face with death all day long. Amen. Listen to that word. That's the scripture, friend. Go back and read it. Go back and read it. Romans 8, 35 to 39. Because what is coming up, what is coming on, the world, where the world is heading today, you're going to need that scripture in your life.
Right.
Fulfilling your life. And you're going to see that there's nothing that can separate you from the love of God. The devil is going to throw everything at you.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. Everything at the child of God, at a Christian. He started already. But the Bible says, nothing shall separate us from the love of God. Amen. When you go back and you read Ephesians 6, we wrestle, we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against what? Spiritual wickedness. In where, friend? Come on, tell me now. In high places. Do you ever see since in my whole life, all my life, I've never seen so much wickedness in high places. Amen. It's happening right now. Right at this very moment, there is the power of hell is attacking the church of Jesus Christ, the body of Christ. But you know what Jesus says? Greater is he that is in me than in you, than he that is in the world. Jesus also says, the gates of hell will not prevail, cannot prevail against his church. And who is his church? It's the body of Christ. The body of Christ is made up of Jew and Gentiles. Glory to God. Don't give me this thing about God's chosen people. All we that came to Christ, we are chosen in the beloved. He don't look at you at a race anymore, whether you're black or you're white or you're rich or you're poor. He don't look like that again. He looks at you as his body. None of us. That's why Jesus died. Jesus died and he forgave the world. Amen. He gave the option that men, whosoever will, may come. Whosoever came, became his body. His body. Christ is the head of that body. Whether you're rich, you're poor, whether you're Jew, you're Gentile. Glory to God. If you're in Christ, you are part of the body. Okay, does that take away all this stigma of racism? Amen. Take away that. You are my brother and my sister in Christ. I don't care if you're watching me today, whether you're white or you're black. You are my brother and my sister. Amen. Have nothing to do with race. Amen. We are one race. The human race. Who created the human race? God created Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. And when we were born, as I said before, we were born in the creation of Adam. Amen. But when we came to Christ, we were created in the image of God. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And the Bible says, nothing shall separate us from the love of God. Amen. Romans 8, 35 and 39. God accept you unconditional. Yes, he do. He didn't only love you. He accept you just the way you are. To the praise and glory of his grace, which he has made us accepted in the beloved. Ephesians 1 and 6, King James Version. Therefore, be kind, compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, friends. Amen. It's time to do that. Forgive them, they offend you. It's time to do that. Ephesians 4:32. Second Corinthians 1 and 3 and 5. Praise be unto God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of compassion and the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all troubles, so that we can comfort those in any trouble with the comfort we ourselves have received from who? From God. That's why he comforts you as his child, so he can go back and comfort somebody else. That's why I'm here this morning trying to give you some hope. Don't watch the news. Listen to the voice of God. Amen. I am not God. I am one of the servants of the Lord. He's using to comfort you. My brother and my sister. give you hope. Amen. The world over there, the devil over there, oh, he's all gone. There's no hope. No, friend, there is hope in the Lord. Amen. Brothers, if someone is caught in a sin, you who are spiritual should restore him gently, but watch yourself. Also, he may be tempted. Galatians 6:1. Yes, I'm here this morning to encourage you to be restored. Amen. Just recognize who you are. You don't even have to say that. He already forgiven you, friend. You already been forgiven. So just realize it. Say, Lord, I thank you. If you offend somebody else, yes, you should go back. You should tell them you should go back and ask them for forgiveness.
Yeah.
But don't ask the Lord for forgiveness. He's already forgiven you. So thank him for his forgiveness. That's the difference. Begging him and thanking him. John 3:17. For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. That's why he came. He came to forgive, took away your sin. He died for your sin. And now he's alive, living, and he's asking you to receive him. He didn't come to condemn you. Amen. Came that you will be saved. John 10:10 said, I come that you may have life and have it abundantly. First he said in that chapter, he said, the thief, the devil, came to kill and to steal and to destroy. But I, Jesus, come that you may have life and have it to the abundant. More abundantly. Do you have abundant life this morning? Do you experience it this morning? Do you rejoice in the abundant life that Christ gave you? Glory to God. He gave you. He's not going to take it away from you. Everything that he gave you is there, friend. He's never going to turn his back on you. He said, I will never leave you, and I will never forsake you. God, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God's will for you in Christ Jesus. 1 Thessalonians 3:5-18. Amen. Glory to God. Give thanks in everything. Mm-hmm. The time is coming when your flesh will not able to even withstand the stuff that is going on. But in all things, give thanks. I'm just encouraging you this morning. And days from now, friend, you might go back and say, Brother Joe said that. What I said, Joe wasn't trying to encourage me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Last scripture for you. Romans 8:28. And we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him. Do you love the Lord this morning? Who have been called according to his purposes. Did he call you for a purpose? Did he just call you to just sit down and listen to junk? I call you for a purpose to encourage somebody else. Did he just call you just to sit down and eat and fill your stomach and just enjoy your life?
Mm-hmm.
He called you for a purpose, friend. He came that none should perish, but that all should have it everlasting life. Everlasting life has been, God is calling every man this morning, today, sorry. Every man, come unto me. Come, friends, come and receive me. The time is coming. Oh, Jesus. The time is coming when you're not going to hear this word. Amen. The time is coming when you're not going to hear a word from the Lord. You're not going to hear God's people preaching the word of God. So now is the day of salvation. Now, N-O-W, now is the accepted time. No, not tomorrow. Man, what are you thinking? It's time to come to him. It's time. The time is now. Don't wait for next week, friend. Next week might be too late. Mm-hmm. Now is it. Accept the time. Now, the Bible says, faith come by hearing. And hearing what? Hearing the word of God. The word of God has been preached to you this morning. And Jesus is saying, I love you unconditional. Come and receive my love. Jesus is saying, he's giving you an example of the prodigal son. Two sons, friend. The teacher there, two sons. The teacher was the father. Amen. He was very rich. And that was just an example, a parable. Glory to God. One decided, well, I'm going to take my money. Give me all that. Just give me my money. He never worked for it. But he said, give me my money. It wasn't his money. It was the father's money. Mm-hmm. So many young people today don't think that. They just think they had to inherit it. Mm-hmm. Inherit something from their parents. Instead of going and get a job. Amen. Since I remember when I was a kid, I was working for $4 a month. I was just a child going to school. But I had a job. Some young people today, they don't think about themselves. They think what mama and what daddy have, what the parents have. What the father gave him, okay son, here is it. Go ahead. He went out there and he had fun. He spent it. He didn't have no control with money. He just decided, because he never worked for it. Mm-hmm. So he just took it and mm-hmm. just spent it.
That's why he spent it.
Huh?
That's why
he spent it. Never worked for it. He never sweat for it. He just go ahead and he have fun. Uh-huh. He spent it with all the prostitutes and all the girls and all the people. And that's all they need from these young people. Just take the money. If you can't give me money, I don't want to know part of you. Amen.
That's right.
But the time came when the Bible in the story that Jesus said the Father was standing every single day. Mm. That's the message I want to give to you this morning. He is a faithful Father. Not the prodigal son. Yeah, that's true. Amen. He came to himself and he decided to go back to his father. But the father is the message. Mm-hmm. The father was standing there every single day, looking mm-hmm. afar off, hoping that one day he's going to see his son. That's the love of God. Hallelujah. He loves us because we love him. Because what? He first loved us. He loved his son so much that every day he was looking for him. Glory to God. And when the son came back, amen, he was so happy. He kissed him on the neck. Hallelujah. He gave him a hug. Put a robe on him, the best robe that they had there. Put a robe, the robe of righteousness upon him. He said, let's have a party. Kill the biggest cattle, the biggest cow that we have on the farm. And let's call all the guests and let's have a party. Because my son was lost, now he's found. That's the faithful father, friend. He's so faithful. No matter what happened in your life, he still loves you. Amen. The child of God, I'm talking to you. No matter what it look like right now, he loves you. Just recognize it. Just remain in his love. Remain in the vine. You are a branch. Just remain in the vine. Hallelujah. And draw from the vine. Draw strength from the vine. No matter what the enemy is saying against, to you and against you this morning, today, glory to God, what he's saying that the church is weak and the church is this. No, if you're in child, and the thing about it, people think that all these big, massive effetus, how they call it, buildings and they think that, oh, that's the church. No, that's not the church. The church, maybe somebody's building that have the thousands of people going there every Sunday morning. Maybe for 5 or 10 of them is saved. most of them, the pastor is not even saved. Amen. So that's not the church we're talking about. We're talking about God's body, the body of Christ, the ecclesia, those that are called out, those that receive, they heard the word and they receive Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior. They say, Lord, I need you. Come and live in me. Glory to God. And Christ came and lived in them, the only hope of glory. So this morning, that's the church we're talking about. That's the church that that Jesus is talking about. See, my sheep, my church, my people. Hallelujah. 10 John 10:10. See, my people. What? Come on. Knows my voice. Hallelujah. My sheep knows my voice. When you hear the voice of God, no matter who is preaching the word, you know, this is of God. You know, hallelujah. Thank you. And I gave them what? Glory to God. And I gave them eternal life. Saying, no man, no woman, no devil in hell could able to pluck them out of my hands. No, because he have you in his hands, in the palm of his hands. Jesus Christ, friends, Jesus Christ. Ooh, glory, our daddy. He have us in his hands. Mm-hmm. No matter all the enemy, and that's why we read the scripture this morning, Romans 8. He said, in all this, let me go back and read it. Amen. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Famine, for naked, for your sake, as it is written for your sake. In all these things, we are more than conquerors. For I am convinced, I like that word, I am convinced that neither death, amen, that cannot even separate you from the love of God. Not even death. Mm-hmm. Because the Bible says, with death, to be absent from the body is the what? Present with the Lord. So that it can't even separate you. And we think that death separates us. Death separates us physically, but not from the love of God. Neither angels nor demon, D-E-M-O-N-S, demons. Neither the present nor the future, nor any power, neither height nor depth, nor any else in all creation will be able to separate me and you, love, those of us that are in the body of Christ, will separate us from the love of God that is in what? Jesus Christ, our Lord. Friend, that's the main, friend. Jesus is the way. He is the truth. He is the life. I saw a prominent preacher the other day on Facebook. I don't know how true it is. And he was with this prominent woman, and he was denying that Jesus is not the only way to heaven. Mm. Wow. And his church is mega, mm-hmm. mega church. Mega, they call them, yeah, mega church. Yes, people running and listen to these people. Yeah. People, yeah, I mean, they're lost. Friend, they're lost. If you're listening and you accept them, that type of message, you're lost, and you need Jesus. Read Galatians 1. Paul said, if they preach another gospel, let them be eternally condemned. Amen. That's a false gospel. Why are you believing that? Like that guy, Jim Jones, he was preaching a mixed gospel, and people believed. And the time came when some of them were too late for them. And not for heaven, if they were born again. They drink the Sinai, the Kool-Aid, and they still went to heaven. If he compelled them to drink it. If they were born again, but somebody again, oh, let me get out of this. They were aware too late. Some of them was aware too late. Some of them did escape in the jungle of Guyana. Yeah, but no, nothing shall separate you, friend, if you are in Jesus Christ. And I say a lot this morning, and I'm going to stop because I can't just keep on going because it's so important. It's so important, so imperative that the Church of Jesus Christ hear this word. The word that to encourage them to realize that nothing shall separate you from his love. Because he loves you unconditional. Amen. He love you just like the prodigal son daddy. Amen. No matter what that son did, glory to God, he was standing and he was praying for his son to come back home. Glory to God. That is the Father we serve. That is the God that I serve. That is the God that I present to you this morning, today. Wherever you are, wherever you are, Jesus loves you no matter what. Amen. Just recognize it in Jesus' name. Father, we thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for your love. Thank you. As we are responders today to you. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Father. Amen. God bless you. I love you. Thank you for joining. Coming on live this morning. We're going to put it on YouTube. So if somebody going to hear the truth of God's word. It should need to be taught to be preached. Mm-hmm. Should need to be truly preached. Mm-hmm. We don't mix it here, friend. We don't sugarcoat it. We don't tell you Jesus plus. We don't tell you Jesus but. You never hear that. It's Jesus. Jesus. All the way. Not Jesus and Moses. Not Jesus and Abraham. No. A greater than Abraham is here. Abraham was great. Thank God for that. Moses was great. But a greater one, Moses, is here. And he's calling you right now. In Jesus' name. God bless you. Bye-bye.